Hi, and welcome into Meet Me in the Movies Open Dialogue. My name is Thomas Manning, and recently had a great chat with the composer Nami Melumad, talking about her incredible career in the music industry, working as a composer on various film projects and entertainment projects, ranging from Thor, Love and Thunder to venturing into the Star Trek universe with Star Trek Prodigy and Star Trek Strange New Worlds. She also worked on a Borat subsequent movie film a few years ago, and she's worked on some video games, collaborated with Michael Giacchino on multiple projects, and even ventured into the hip-hop realm of working with Logic on his 2017 album Everybody. So I hope you guys enjoy this conversation. It was really just great talking about her career that's been very successful for many years, and hope you guys enjoy listening and watching.
So I'll start out kind of with a general overview. Looking at your career, you've worked on such an impressive array and wide range of project styles, you know, from short films to documentaries, television, and some big budget feature films. So out of these, is there a particular size of project or scale of production that you feel yourself drawn to more than others, or is it kind of just a sense of you like to get those different experiences?
Well, it's fun to have different experiences. I mean, obviously, I'm drawn to like that little indie project size, like Thor. That's a great indie.
Of course, yeah.
Yeah, that's and it's because it's my favorite actors. It's massive. It's huge. It's the content I like watching. Obviously, and then on top of that, you have these like great incentive in a form of a huge orchestra, 96 players, and you have this like huge choir, and guitars and like drums that, everything that, a composer can dream of. So obviously that's a pretty, fun work environment. But I also do like, the smaller scale stuff. Star Trek is not really small scale. We still have like a 60 piece orchestra, between 50 to 60. But even smaller scale projects, like the one I'm working on now, which is like this little romantic comedy. And it's really fun because you get to tell a story, you still get to tell the same emotions. You still get to, to be part of, it's just a different concept, but it's as great, so yeah, sorry. I'm excited with anything I do, really, in the challenge that it will present, like whether it's a huge orchestra or a smaller ensemble, or maybe something that's not entirely acoustic at all. Like it could be, I've done projects that had like synth stuff, and percussions, and like more like all sorts of flute weirdo things that I have been doing with some audio manipulations or like sound toys, stuff like that. I enjoy telling the story. If I could pick, take my pick, I'd go for like a Marvel or Pixar, like one of those big stuff. Yeah.
And I believe you've also done some work composing music for stage plays and live theater, especially kind of earlier in your career. And So I'm wondering, how does that approach compare when you're writing for live performances versus writing music for something that's already been filmed and produced?
Oh, that's such a great question. Wow. So when you're writing for a live performance, you want it to be as simple as it gets, because there's not a lot of rehearsals, and then because people have to, it has to be performed live. The less mistakes that happen, the better. So you got to be mindful of that. You also have to be mindful of the ensemble. Like, as I just mentioned, like Thor is like such a huge orchestra. With live plays, usually you don't have such a big ensemble. Maybe you'll have a few players, and often the actors will be singing on stage, or like you have to you have to be mindful of the ensemble you're writing for. So your musical choices will sometimes be just, you know, informed by that. I'm not saying for the good and the bad. Actually, sometimes it'll be even better. Cause when you have limitations, you know, often you'll come up with something more exciting because that's your limitations. You have to, you know. So yeah, it'll push you out of your comfort zone. And I like that. I guess I would love to go back to that. The thing is, like, it's oftentimes I had to be there, like, for rehearsals and for performances. And that is very time consuming. Plus, I am not very good at being on stage as a performer. That's part of why I wanted to be a composer for film and TV, because then I don't have to be on the stage performing and making a lot of mistakes. I still have some dreams about being on stage, and they're usually not great dreams. Like, it's I don't know if it's fear of audience or what, but yeah, not for me. I'll leave that to someone who's an expert.
Yeah, so you've written music for, you know, film and television and live stage performances, but you've also done a few, you know, other worked in a few other areas of the music industry. You collaborated in 2017 with Logic on his album Everybody, and, you know, Logic, he's such a fantastic hip-hop artist, and that album in particular has just always impressed me and how creative it is in all aspects, both musically and narratively. And I think your orchestrations provided a lot to those foundations. So are there any details you recall from working on that project, on that project, that kind of challenged you to do something unique and kind of flex a different kind of creative muscle?
Yeah, so this was, I think it was the first time I got to orchestrate something on such a big scale, because I was, like, kind of after school then, and like, you know, relatively new to the US and all of that. And I had worked as a music preparation person, like I was doing copying and stuff. And so I got to be on a lot of sessions, a lot of pop music sessions. And usually, you know, we'd have like 12 string players or like a small orchestra, you know, 18 players, 20 players. And this was like the biggest one that I've done to that point. And there was like a main, like it was a string orchestra, really. And this was the first time I got a chance to, you know, to go for it and to orchestrate. And so that was a big deal for me. It still is. And that album went to be very, very big. But, you know, and another really cool part of it was that we did it at Warner Brothers. And I remember walking into the studio. I was already, like, you know, putting all the music on the stands and, like, super excited to hear, you know, the orchestrations are being played. And then Logic walks in with his entourage of, like, people. And, you know, I thought, okay, well, you know, he's a rapper. He's not gonna, like, you know. But then he walked up to every person in the room, like the people who were working on the stage and setting up the mics, and me, and, like, really everyone, you know, the small people, you know, the small workers. And he was so kind. And so, like, he introduced himself. He was like, I'm Logic. Nice to meet you. Thank you so much for helping out on this. I'm super excited, you know. And he was, like, so real and genuine. Like, he was all of a sudden this, like, sweet person. And I really did not anticipate any of that, you know, because he's such a big, you know, big guy. And that, the whole thing, you know, that little gesture made everything so much more fun. And yeah, it was a really beautiful experience. And I kind of take that from him, you know. Every time I walk into a new room or a new environment, I'll be introducing myself and, you know, be kind and nice to everyone, because that makes it way more fun, you know, for everyone, really. So yeah, it was really fun.
Yeah, and another part of that project, the 1-800 song on that album was so special for so many people. So what does that mean for you to have been able to work on a song that was significant on a broader cultural level, but, you know, also on a very intimate personal level to a lot of people?
Yeah, you know, honestly, it helped me too. It's really interesting. Like, but, you know, we all have these, like, really troublesome times, and especially 2020 was, like, kind of hard for me, because also, so there was, like, a couple of projects I was really looking forward to, and they were, like, either delayed or canceled completely, or moved on without me. Like, there was, like, a lot of stuff going on, and you know, oftentimes I was like, you know, I was trying to find some more meaning, and that song was helpful to me too. Like I would listen to it. So obviously I take big pride in like helping others with the song, but I also got to experience it, you know, single-handedly, like what that song meant. So, so yeah. And then, you know, anytime I hear Alicia Cara, I was like, I loved her since like the very beginning of her career. So it was also really special that she was part of the album. Yeah. I mean, isn't that the purpose of music though? Like to lift us up and like to help us where, you know, both as a society, as an, and as individuals, like, you know, I feel like Beethoven helped me a lot. Like, and so, so did Logic. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, thank you so much for sharing that. That's really interesting to hear. Yeah. And as you mentioned earlier, you alluded to earlier, how you've recently ventured into the Star Trek universe with Star Trek Prodigy and also Strange New Worlds. And there's obviously a magnificent, rich history to this saga and this franchise, almost 60 years. Almost 60 years now. I think it was 1966 was the original debut of Star Trek. So you were certainly up to the challenge, but was that kind of a daunting undertaking for you at the beginning, just figuring out how you were going to step foot into a story with so much history and so much weight in pop culture?
Oh yeah, I mean, no pressure at all. there was definitely you know, some pressure, especially because all these like an incredibly iconic composers took part of this franchise. You know, I grew up listening to Jerry Goldsmith. I grew up listening to Alexander Courage and Michael Giacchino and James Horner and all these like incredibly talented and phenomenal composers. And so you have to like make sure your music is just as great, which seems to be a bit of a you know, big task. But at the same time, I feel like if producers believe in you and showrunners believe in you and Giacchino believes in you, then you have to, you know, you kind of embrace that as like that outside confidence really kind of ensures your inner confidence too. And it really helps, you know, because in those moments where you're not sure of something, you're like, well, they trust me to do a good job. They think I can do it, so I can do it. So yeah, but it, I also always have had that confidence. So this is just for moments where I'm not sure about something. But yeah, I think growing up on this music actually helped me a lot because I'm already familiar with, you know, what my ear is looking for. Like a lot of times I'll be like, it's not exactly, you know, I'm looking at the piano and be like, you know, trying different intervals. Like, this is not exactly what I was, you know, and yeah, having such a good knowledge of the original series and the previous shows as well, like, you know, TNG, DS9, Voyager, like all of, and the movies, of course, it really helps in understanding your musical decisions. If you know it well, if you know what has been done, you can build on that and renew it and make it more exciting, more fresh, but it will still line up within that universe. So I guess being a trap key helps. Yeah, and of course, a lot of coffee too.
You gotta have that coffee. Yeah, yeah. I am definitely a caffeine addict myself. I actually work at a coffee shop, which probably doesn't help things, but.
Nice.
Yeah, yeah.
Coffee is the best. It's
most certainly
catalyzer for track music, especially if it involves Janeway.
I mean. Exactly. Yep. And you mentioned your collaborations with Michael Giacchino. And there's one project a couple years ago that really caught my attention when I was kind of researching more into your career. So y'all worked on the video game Medal of Honor Above and Beyond. And also congrats on winning an award from the International Film Music Critics Association. So yeah, I noticed that so
cool. I did not see that coming, but yay.
Yeah. Yeah, so just congrats, but also I imagine that was quite a fascinating task, developing music for a medium like that. So just how does your approach to that medium differ from other mediums?
Oh, wow. Yeah, that was such a cool project. And it's, yeah, you're right. It's very different to write for a video game, especially because it's like not a linear scenario like a film or a show that there's like a, you know, a timeline. You see what the characters are doing. You react to them like music usually reacts. So with that, it was more of a, like, you know, a lot of room for imagination first, because you're working on an animation that's not entirely final. So a lot of times, you know, there's going to be like soldiers coming at you. There's going to be all sorts of things happening, but you don't see them yet because you're working on a work in progress. And, you know, it really helped that they put in the sound for the game. Like a lot of the temp sounds were there. So it sounded realistic in terms of like the environment and the feel of it. But yeah, there were like, you know, all sorts of levels in the game that I worked on without even seeing them. Like, so it was a lot of room for imagination. The other thing is that it's relatively more open. Like there's more flexibility, more place for creativity. You know, it's kind of like more of a blank page. It's not really a blank page because you're still influenced by the script and by the level, what's happening in that level, the intensity of the music that you want to do. So there's like, you know, factors that are still the same as in a narrative film. But, you know, generally there's more room for your musical decisions. You know, you're not, you know, obligated by dialogue or by a certain timing. So you can make your choices however you want to make them, which was really fun and super interesting. And yeah, so basically what our concept was that there's going to be like three layers to every level. So three layers of intensity, and it should keep growing all the time. So the first one would be like more like a stealth or like a, you know, before the battle scenario, and then like a mid action. So it's like, you know, it's action, but it's not like the most, you know, it's like one-on-one combat or one on a few combat. And then the third one would be like super intense, like big fight tanks, you know, what like things that are really, really, you know, more stressful and scary. So it was really cool to also like take a theme and kind of build on it for these like different, you know, variations of tempo and stress level, really, and intensity level. Yeah. And then it was also interesting because to prepare for this, I had studied all of Michael's score from beforehand. But also he recommended that I read some books about D-Day and kind of like learn, you know, get the feeling of what it was like to be a soldier in D-Day, and that experience for the war, like, you know, and I read a lot, like I you know, Stephen Ambrose, I think that's the writer. I read like a lot of his books, and that really inspired me because I was like, okay, this is the mindset. It was kind of, you know, sometimes a bit hard to read those things because you're like, wow, they had to endure a lot. And I wanted that feeling to come into the music in the game too, because, you know, it's not just a game about fighting. It's also like there's a little more to that, you know, the purpose of that war. And then there was these documentaries that they added, with like interviews with veterans and with Colette, who was a resistance fighter, for the French resistance. And she was a teenage girl. And so you're like, you know, there was so much meaning in that, like, you know, the sacrifice that these people did. Like, so I liked that they took the game into that with that added perspective. So it's not just a shooting game, you know? So yeah, it was overall a good experience, just really, really different than working on a film.
Yeah, I'm glad you mentioned Colette, because I found that just really interesting how there was a companion piece to the video game, and they're intrinsically connected and they comment on similar subject matter, but, you know, one is an action video game and the other is a very intimate documentary. So what was that process like in the sense of those two companion pieces kind of interacting with each other, right, and, you know, your approach to that?
Right. Well, first of all, we decided to, it was different directors. So, you know, we worked with Peter Hirschman on the actual game. And then with Anthony Giacchino, on the documentaries. And so the documentaries, you know, obviously have a different direction to begin with from a filmmaker's perspective, but also like just the tone and the vibe. And we decided that like it should be completely, you know, different from the score of the game. So it will be two distinctive things, but that all of the documentaries will still have the same, a similar feel, because that is like that gallery part of the game. So yeah, and then again, you want to tell this. This is more of a like a, it's not a narrative situation, but a documentary. But you're still following the story that Colette tells you. So you know, in a way, there's a timeline. It's like it's more like a movie that you score. And so yeah, I you know, in documentaries, you don't want to intervene too much. Like you want to let things happen, and you don't want to over tell, you know, with emotions or like make it melodramatic. So a lot of the choice, I remember actually my first catch was like Michael looked at it and he was like, yeah, maybe we should do something a little less big and you know, less is more kind of thing. And I thought that was a good direction, because I was like, you know, it all of a sudden opened that story to your interpretation, your emotion as the viewer. So, you know, just adding a little bit here and there and just accentuating those certain moments where she goes to that tunnel and like, you know, kind of create that horror for, you know, in the tunnel, like make that, but it wasn't a lot, you know, creating that horror moment. It was just like, you know, some basses, some really scratchy high strings, and that combination was so eerie and like disturbing, but it also allowed for your emotions to come through without being without overstepping. So that was like a lot of that documentary was about like finding this fine tuning of a score. So yeah, ultimately I'm really proud of it. And then yeah, there was like other documentaries too. Yeah, it was a fun experience for sure. And also just to get to work with these stories, you know, because I wouldn't be, you know, I didn't know about all of that. Like I felt like it was personally enriching, you know.
Yeah, most certainly. And you know, I definitely want to give you a chance here to talk a little bit about one of your latest projects, which you talked a little bit about earlier, but Thor: Love and Thunder, and working with Michael on that one. So kind of how were the music cues delegated between you and Michael? You know, were there certain areas of the score that maybe you worked on more than him and vice versa? Just what was that creative partnership like?
Right. So at this point, Michael and I had worked together for like 4 years. It makes it easier and more smooth in terms of the collaboration. I feel like I understand, you know, his choices and what, and he kind of understands mine. You know, it really helps that he trusts me with those decisions. I wasn't supposed to be working on this, but there was a scheduling conflict for Michael, because I'm sure, as you know, you probably know, he's directing a film for Marvel. So and Thor got really delayed. Like they had the reshoots and they had to do like a lot of, you know, unexpected things. And so, you know, basically Michael was like just not super available to do all the stuff. So he texted me if I can do some cues, and I'm like, yeah. I mean, you don't need to add, I mean, you have me at like four. So yeah, it was you know, it started, you know, at that point of the process, he already recorded like the main themes. He already recorded a big chunk of the score. So I was like able to sort of learn what he did. It's like, okay, these are the choices. I'm like, oh, an orchestra without woodwinds, interesting, you know, because I didn't know all of that. Like I got added to the folder where all the stuff where I'm like, oh god, like there's a lot of learning to do in like really quick time. Like I have literally 2 days to figure out what's going on here. And I listened to it and repeat the stuff that had already been recorded. And basically, you know, we got a cut almost every day. And so, you know, just figuring out what else needs to be done and how, you know, how do we do it? So yeah, Michael sent me some of his sketches, and some of them, I completed those sketches. I'm like, okay, it really helped, because I think that's the first time he sends me like his sketches. So it's really interesting to see, like, you know, how he approaches a scene, what a sketch looks like with him. And then, you know, I always get excited when I get new music for him, because I'm like, oh, I'm the first one to hear a Michael, a new Michael thing. So that's really cool. But like, I still have that fangirl feel sometimes. So I sent him, like, you know, I sent him things to review, and he'll be like, oh, well, this is great, you know, let's send it off. Or he'll be like, oh, you know, maybe we should change this and that. And I'm like, oh, I should have thought about this. Like, he's so smart. I'm not, you know, ultimately they changed so much in the film that I, you know, it's kind of hard to be like, oh, you know, because I worked on some stuff in the beginning, I worked some stuff in the middle, some stuff in the end. Like, it's very, like, mixed. And then sometimes there's really surprising, but because they continue to edit the film long after the score has been recorded, and I think they had about, like, I think ultimately about 110 minutes of music that they could use. At the end of it, it's way less than the movie, but also a lot of scenes that were initially there and we scored are not in the cut. So there was like a bit of a mashup there towards the end. They also moved scenes like that were supposed to be, you know, at that point of the film, and now they're here. And so also with music, I remember there was like something I wrote for a certain spot. And then I, you know, in the screening, I see it in a different spot. I'm like, oh, okay. I mean, that works. Yeah. So there's like all these things. So it's kind of hard to say, like, okay, which scenes were what, but it was really, you know, I'm very proud of it. Like, it was really fun, and the challenge was awesome. Like, you know, that you don't have a lot of time to do it. I really enjoy that. I guess I like not sleeping, so.
Yeah, after just graduating college, you know, I didn't get a lot of sleep during that time either. So I understand how, you know, sometimes when you're kind of in a different state of mind, when you're sleep deprived, that's when your creativity really kicks in. So.
Yeah. I mean, you're in the place, you're in the mood, and the adrenaline is a big part of it. And I feel like the adrenaline was definitely there for a long time on this Marvel project. Yeah. It's a lot of, and you know, like sometimes I'll send you something that needs to be ready for tomorrow, and you know, and you're like, well, when am I going to do that? But you have to do it, because otherwise it will just not be ready. And then I have to, you know, I have to rise up to the challenge. Like, I have to up my game, and, you know, working with these top people, like, you know, you have to do it right. Yeah.
You know, I know your time is somewhat limited today, but before I let you go, I'd love to ask about one of your other films in particular. And I think in a roundabout way, you can almost connect it to the tone of Thor. So, you know, Thor: Love and Thunder, it's definitely a heavy comedy, but it's a fantasy comedy. It gets very absurd and kind of stretches into a lot of abstract areas. But a few years ago, you worked on a project that was very much based in reality, and but also very absurd and bizarre in a lot of sense. And that's, you know, the Borat sequel a couple years ago. So I had to have to ask about your experience working on Borat's subsequent movie film. Oh, man. And just, you know, Sacha Baron Cohen, he's a genius. And I think that movie represents a pinnacle of what he's been able to do in his career. So I just would love to hear about anything specifically about your contributions to that project that really stand out in your memory.
Oh, man, this was such a fun project. God, it was hilarious from the beginning to the end. Like, even the meetings, it was really funny. And yeah, I really enjoyed it. This was actually another Michael collaboration, because Michael was brought on to advise on the score. And I, you know, he brought me in to do some arrangements and to help out with some additional music. So I used a theme from Aaron Baron Cohen, who's like an incredible writer. That theme is like, I can still hear it in my head. Very, very catchy. And so it was, you know, first of all, I learned a lot about like Eastern European music and like, you know, Kazakhstan music and Georgian music, like very, you know, it was a lot of brass band stuff, like a lot of things I haven't, you know, even touched on before. So I feel like I learned a lot from that. But yeah, so it was a little bit of a mess. I will say that. And I remember it was, you know, after we did it, it was like a good preparation for, you know, cause the schedule was just so intense. And I felt like that would be a good preparation for another scenario where things are like super, super quick, have to be turned around super quick and super, you know, again, adrenaline is the key word, I guess. So there was that. Yeah, it was like 5 weeks or so. That was very, very quick. And we recorded the orchestra at like 1 a.m. because they were in Europe. And so for us, it's like 1 a.m., which is really funny. Like, I mean, the whole thing was just like, kind of like you see in the movie. It was funny. It was intense. And Sacha Baron Cohen speaks Hebrew half the movie too. So I, you know, as a Hebrew speaker, I'm from Israel. I understood like a lot of the jokes that people didn't like, you know, because there's a scene where he's talking, you know, he says some stuff to his daughter. I mean, in the movie. And basically what he's saying is, oh, I hear there's schnitzels for lunch. Let's go. Like, this is so not what they translated. So a lot of those jokes, it was just really pure fun to work on it. So yeah, I wish myself a lot of more projects like that.
Well, Nami, I can't thank you enough for your time today and just for such a delightful conversation. And what you bring creatively to so many projects is very special. And thank you again for everything today.
Oh, thank you. All right. Great questions.
Yeah. Hopefully we get a chance to talk again soon. Yeah.
All right. Sounds good. Bye. Thanks.
Have a great afternoon. Thanks.
Yeah.